Bonjour. Thank you for the kind invitation. I'm very happy to be here today to share what I think in this seminar. The topic that I'm going to talk about is Abe's revisionist nationalism, with a focus on history and education issues in particular. And as Jean-Michel said, I'd like to spend the first 45 minutes or so in sharing my thoughts first, and then leave enough time for you to ask me questions so that we can think further on the basis of what I initially share with you. First, I'd like to begin with the question, of course, where this is all coming from. And, you know, taking Japan back, as many of you would know, is actually the campaign slogan of Abe's LDP back in December 2012, when the LDP returned to power. Nihon torimodosu. And that is actually quite a powerful and also telling slogan, because I think it really comes very deeply from the kind of worldview and the history that Abe, in fact, has himself. But before I get to that, you know, I'd like to begin by taking a note of the historical issues, the history issues themselves, in terms of trying to kind of get a grip of, you know, where it comes from. Because one thing I think that is often neglected is the fact that the history issue, so-called history issues, even though this is the 70th anniversary of the end of the Second World War, is not, the history issues are not 70 or old. They're actually younger, if I can put it that way, because the history issues did not begin in 1945 with the Japanese surrender. And that is part of the reason why it's still lingering. The issues are still lingering, and the Japanese government is having such a hard time you know, coming to grips with those difficulties. And but anyway, the history issues. I mean, one thing that is often talked about, of course, is the comparison between Japan and Germany. Germany has been more successful in, you know, leaving the past where it should be and moving along. And today, it's rare to hear the French people or the Polish or the Jews criticizing Germany for reviving the Nazi ghost. You know, in comparison, of course, Japan appears rather, you know, strikingly less able to put the past in the past. And I think that might be a fairly useful starting point. And I mean, one thing that is, I think, quite important here is that in the Japanese case, even though we tend to put Japan in the same category as Nazi Germany and fascist Italy, militarist Japan did not come into being in the same way. And what I'm talking about here is the fact that the Japanese Empire turned militaristic from within, if I can put it that way, or from above. And what I'm saying is that it's not like there was somebody like Hitler who's just a failed artist, you know, putting together a, kind of a social political movement using violent and electoral means to seize power. In the Japanese case, there's no equivalent of Hitler or Mussolini, in the sense that there was never a really spontaneous or societal mass movement that seized power from the outside. It is, in fact, the traditional elites of Japan that turned militaristic. And so, and this, I think, is easy to grasp when you think of the fact that Abe, of course, is very, very proud of his grandfather, Kishi Nobusuke, who was a cabinet minister of the Tojo cabinet, which attacked Pearl Harbor. But also, earlier before that, he was also a top bureaucrat serving as the number two official in the puppet government in Manchuria. And Kishi, like Abe, of course, is from the Yamaguchi Prefecture, which is the Choshu domain. And so this is, of course, only one example. But what happened, of course, is the major oligarchs who came to into place and began the modernization process, kept a grip on power, and it is not an outside takeover that turned Japan into a militarist regime, but it's really from within. And that actually provided, presented a big challenge for the American occupation when they tried to demilitarize and democratize Japan. Because of course in the case of Germany, or West Germany, you get rid of the Nazis. And of course that is not, you know, that is harder than it might seem perhaps, but it's actually even harder in the Japanese case because you purge everybody who is involved, then you are not left with anybody who really have any experience of government. And you don't want that either. And so this is part of the reason why the democratization process in post-war Japan was not that thorough, and the purging and the punishment of the people who are responsible for the war were not held to the same degree in account compared to West Germany, I think. That's one difference. And I don't know, you know, what can be done about this, to be honest. But, you know, it's of course in the past, but that's part of the reason why the Japanese post-war leaders were very quick to reinstate not just people like Kishi, who already become prime minister in 1958, but also the National Diet, the Parliament of Japan, pardons all of the class A war criminals very quickly after Japan regains independence. And you know, for that vote, for the parliamentary resolution that restored honor to the class A war criminals, even the Socialist Party voted alongside in favor. And that shows, you know, the degree to which the ruling elites of Japan from the very early post-war period have had difficulty in turning a new page because of this very strong continuity of the conservative elite that, you know, to a degree even continues today. So that's one key difference, I think. And the second key difference is to do with the with the post-war protest movement and criticisms, in particular the baby boom generation, you know, student revolts, the Japanese version of you know, the student protest in Quartier Latin, you know, there was the same equivalent. And of course in the German case, the baby boomers who were critical of the conservatives went further in trying to hold those people who collaborated with the Nazi regime to account. And it was quite key in the West German case that the Social Democrats entered a grand coalition with the Christian Democrats as early as 1966. And by 1969, you had Willy Brandt becoming you know, the first center-left prime minister chancellor of West Germany. And of course, the symbolism of Willy Brandt kneeling in Auschwitz is a very powerful moment of the Germans, you know, coping with the wartime past with their own hands. And that did not happen in Japan. The conservatives, the LDP, continued to be in power. And in fact, during the same period, Sato Eisaku continued to be, I mean, to date, the longest serving prime minister of Japan. And the protest movements never resulted in a change of government. And, you know, I think that kind of thing is, you know, the significance of that, I think, can be understood, you know, when you think of the, you know, the kind of the French equivalent in terms of, you know, la grande alternance of François Mitterrand, for example, you know, how significant that kind of change of government can be in dealing with issues that were left undealt with by the largely dominant conservatives of the post-war period. In the Japanese case, that never really quite happened. Of course, the people who were critical of the conduct of the Japanese empire and dared to question their own fathers and grandfathers of their wartime conducts, they never came to seize national power, but they did stay sometimes in the academia, in civil society organizations. So, of course, within Japan, there are people who have been working to question and to investigate what the Japanese military did in Asia and beyond, but they never really you know, went high up in the state machinery. And I think that is another significant divergence between Japan and West Germany that made it harder for the Japanese to come to grips with the wartime past. And finally, I think one really key difference perhaps, and in the Japanese case, you know, something that is going to eventually lead to the birth, belated birth of history issues in the 1980s onwards, because it is in the, only in the 1980s that history issues really become something that was of any significance politically. You know, that is, of course, very late in the post-war period. The reason why these issues were not dealt with earlier as political or diplomatic issues is because 50 years ago, in 1965, when Japan signed the basic treaties with South Korea, and built the diplomatic relations, normalized diplomatic relations with South Korea was still under military rule. And of course, the South Korean military was a creature initially of the Japanese Imperial military. Today's President Park's own father was, of course, raised and trained as an officer of the Japanese Empire, and so South Korean leaders who were still in place had no particular reason they wanted to to dig out the dirty secrets of the Japanese Empire with any great zeal. And this, of course, also is particularly pertinent when you come to think of an issue like the comfort woman issue. The comfort woman issue was not dealt with in the Tokyo War Crimes Tribunal in 1945 after the war. To begin with, this, of course, is not the time when the feminists were big in number and pointing to thorny issues that that affected the women population in particular. So violence against women was largely ignored, if not thoroughly ignored, in the Tokyo War Crimes Tribunal to begin with. And of course, in 1965, when the Korean leaders shook hands with the Japanese leaders, they were not particularly interested in discussing these issues either. But of course, on the state-to-state level, Japan, did come to an agreement with South Korea. And so the Japanese conservatives to date put an emphasis on the fact that legally Japan, owes South Korea nothing. To a degree, it's true. It's true in the sense that in terms of state-to-state compensation and apology, it's already been done. And it was done 50 years ago. But of course, compensation to the degree to which the Japanese side gave to the South Koreans never reached those comfort women. These are for the reasons why they become later issues. Much the same can be said about the Chinese. When Japan normalized ties with Beijing, with the PRC government in 1972, again, it was a time when Mao Zedong and Zhou Enlai were still alive. And so this is the first charismatic revolutionary leaders of China finding an interest in shaking hands with Japan and restoring ties and receiving aids when the relationship between PRC and Soviet Union were getting more and more difficult. And so this was the time when those Chinese leaders were again also able to say, to the domestic audience that the Japanese are no longer villains. And they, in fact, even employed a rather interesting kind of Marxist rhetoric in saying that, well, the people who are responsible are not the ordinary Japanese, but are the elites of Japan. These are the people who, in fact, ordinary Japanese are as much victims of the Japanese Empire as the Chinese public were. And that argument, of course, is less and less credible in an increasingly liberal China. But back at the time, the Chinese leaders had enough authority to impose that view on the domestic audience. And using panda and whatnot, they nurtured the kind of atmosphere of friendship between Japan and China rather successfully. And that is 1972. What I'm saying is that history issues come into being only with the liberalization, and in the South Korean case, democratization of South Korea. And toward the end of the Cold War, China begins market reforms in 1978. In South Korea, democratization movement becomes stronger and stronger in the 1980s. And by 1987, democratization declaration is issued in South Korea. Seoul hosts the Olympics in 1988. And so it goes hand in hand with those developments. In other words, history issues become real issues, even though on the elite government level, they were dealt with, supposedly, before they were even born, but they were not actually killed before birth, because when society became looser and freer, then people wanted to have a say, and they were not quite happy with what they never quite got. And so what happened was that, of course, in the Chinese case, there's a twist that, June 4th incident, Tiananmen Square massacre happens in 1989. And from that time onwards, liberalization of politics of China is, of course, is stymied. But that gives a greater reason for the Chinese leaders to, in fact, give a boost to what is called patriotic education, vilifying the Japanese and the Japanese soldiers, in particular in popular culture and in education, and in order to make up for the fact that there's no longer communist ideology to draw the country together. But in any case, with the liberalization and the democratization of South Korea, history issues are finally born. And so it's only in 1982 that the history textbooks of Japan draw the attention of the Chinese and the South Koreans, and protests are lodged. So as diplomatic issue, I think you can say that it's really around in the 1980s, beginning with perhaps the history, the first history textbook controversy of 1982, that history issues become real diplomatic issues. This, of course, kind of thing is repeated when Nakasone visits the Yasukuni Shrine in his official capacity on August 15th, the day that is commemorated inside Japan as the day of Japan's surrender. The Chinese, in particular, protest, and the first comfort woman to come to come out with her own name in front of the TV camera was Mrs. Kim Hackson in 1991. So it's only in the 1980s and early 1990s that history issues become serious diplomatic issues. That has direct connection with the liberalization and democratization of those two countries. What, of course, that means is that the history issues were, from the very beginning, very hard issues to deal with, because these were no longer issues that can be dealt with on the elite level. That weakness or that difficulty is in fact exposed time and again, because the elites initially, particularly between Japan and South Korea, but also with China, initially they tried to make amends. They did try to resolve these issues. But sometimes, they take it back home and then they face domestic opposition. So they're back to square one. And this kind of thing was repeated all the time. And of course, in the Japanese side, too, the 1980s and going into the 1990s is also the time when the LDP single party rule is collapsing. And the LDP loses power for the first time in 1993, as you know. And so, it is not as if the ruling elites of Japan also have an iron grip control over society either. These, make a very volatile background in which the elites have to somehow play a very complex game, both facing domestic audience and dealing with international interlocutors. In terms of Japan's responses, it is easy to forget, but the initial responses of the Japanese conservatives, even in the 1980s and up to the mid-1990s, was actually quite liberal and open-minded. And so sometimes, of course, the Chinese government today in particular make the point that Japan never apologized properly and so forth. That is simply not true. The Japanese government did apologize time and again. And of course, there are reasons why people are not quite sure whether Japan ever apologized, but as a matter of fact, Japan did apologize, and even the conservatives tried to make amends with the two countries in particular. And so when the history textbook becomes an issue in 1982, the Japanese government responds by issuing a statement known as Miyazawa statement, because Miyazawa was the chief cabinet secretary at the time. That says that the Minister of Education, when going through the screening process of the history textbooks, they have to be considerate of the national sentiments of the neighbors. And that clause is still in place today. And so, which is an interesting compromise, because the Ministry of Education is not saying that we should educate our youth about the truth. What they're saying that you have to be nice to your neighbors. So it's whitewash. But, you know, the conservatives are their best in a way. And it's certainly better than, you know, educating the pupils with revisionist textbooks. So, you know, as timid as the efforts are made. And similarly, when Nakasone visited the Yasukuni Shrine in his official capacity and the Chinese protested, Nakasone's second-hand right-hand man, Gotoda, who was also the chief cabinet secretary at the time, in the following year, in 1986, issues a statement that says that basically he's not going anymore. The Japanese prime minister wouldn't go, Nakasone wouldn't go because, you know, it hurts the feelings of the neighbors again. So that kind of pattern becomes rather embedded in the conservative response, relatively liberal response to the criticism from the neighbors, that Japan was trying to work in a way that is going to be respected in the international community. And this is the kind of liberal internationalism that was prevalent at the time. And this, of course, is in the context, as I said, of the coming of the end of the Cold War, right? Gorbachev is going through the perestroika process and all that sort of thing. And the Americans, of course, you know, under Reagan, but they are also showing signs of fatigue in the Cold War arms race. And so there's a growing demand on Japan to become you know, a bigger player politically also. So not just being an economic success, but also contributing to the international security arrangement and all that sort of thing. And the conservatives at the time, even hawks and nationalists like Nakasone, decided that in the interest of Japan, from their point of view, because he, Nakasone and others, wanted Japan to play a bigger role in the international community, and perhaps even dispatching the self-defense forces overseas, in order to do so, you need to make the Chinese and the Koreans reasonably happy. Otherwise, you can't do that. And so they made a choice. Nakasone is actually a, you know, quite a strong revisionist, you know, in his private capacity, but he was adult enough to understand and to figure out that for the interest of Japan, from his point of view, Japan cannot be shackled by the wartime past, and so we need to move along. And that's why he dealt with the history issues in a way that is different from what Abe is doing today. This continues on with the Kono statement in 1993 in response to, of course, you know, the comfort woman issue. In 1993, Hosokawa becomes the first non-LDP prime minister since 1955, but also he also becomes the first prime minister of Japan to refer to the Second World War as a war of aggression. It's kind of late, but you know, he did it. In 1993, in an official speech, he referred to the World War II as a war of aggression. In 1995, under the Socialist Prime Minister Murayama, of course, Murayama's statement is issued, and the Asian Women's Fund is also, you know, set up as a sort of compromise attempt to make compensation to the former comfort woman, the sex slaves. And in the case of the Asian Women's Fund, it's a typical example of the difficult, you know, that shows how difficult of a game that these countries are playing. You know, the South Korean government was initially willing to go along with the Japanese proposal, because the Japanese government to date, in fact, keeps the position that legally Japan owes South Korea nothing, and therefore they can't pay compensation out of state money directly. And if you start doing that, of course, there are going to be more, you know, demands and claims, for sure, from those people who are, you know, forced to work for Japan, the Japanese Empire. And so they don't want to open that lid of can, you know, that lid. And so what they did is to set up this fund as a third-party organization to which the Japanese state pay in half of the money, and half of the money is collected by the goodwill of the Japanese public. And so this is a compromise. And you attach to that a letter signed by the Japanese Prime Minister, and you kind of make compensation. It seemed like a good idea at the time, and it did work with some countries, but it failed disastrously with Taiwan and with South Korea. the two countries that was, you know, most severely affected by the conflict on an issue. It worked, for example, with the Netherlands, and it worked also with Indonesia. And of course, Indonesia is not a democracy, so, you know, the government gets the money, build hospitals, and that's the end of the story. The individuals did not get the compensation, but they could do that way because it's an authoritarian regime. In the case of South Korea, the civil society actors who have been helping the comfort women, the sex slaves, get very angry, and the South Korean government basically had to turn around and say, after all, you know, we can't accept this. It's not going to work. And so the Japanese government was, of course, very disappointed and angered by the South Korean government response, because they thought that they worked on it together, and then they were let down. So I'm not justifying, but I'm explaining from the Japanese government or the conservative perspective, it often appears as if the South Koreans are moving the goalposts. And, you know, from the Japanese perspective or the conservative perspective, that's often how it kind of, you know, it appears. And I think it's sort of, you know, something one can understand, if not something that we necessarily endorse. So these are the kind of responses initially, and it worked to, you know, to a degree until the mid-1990s. And here comes Mr. Abe, who's a very interesting figure. And he's a very interesting figure because if you look at his political career, you can understand why he chose this Taking Japan Back as a campaign slogan in 2012. The first election in which he enters parliament is actually 1993. So in other words, you know, because his father was also a politician, a faction leader and the foreign minister of Nakasone government in the 1980s. So Abe was involved in politics of a kind, but, you know, in his own person, he enters politics for the first time in 1993, at the time when the LDP falls from power. So in other words, he joins the LDP, he joins the parliament, but then he finds himself in opposition, which is, of course, not something one expects when you enter politics as an LDP candidate, particularly a hereditary politician. And not only that, you know, so he wants to take back Japan, you know, so because he was deprived of him and them when he first got elected. But it's not the only thing. In that election, when the LDP lost the majority and Miyazawa government became the last LDP government out of 38 consecutive years, when Abe got elected and he saw the results, he must have been disappointed that he was going to be in opposition. And then, in the closing days of the Miyazawa government, really only days before Hosokawa was sworn in as the new Prime Minister of Japan, the Kono statement is issued. It is at that timing when the Miyazawa government is not only a lame duck, in fact it's dead already, at least it's brain dead. At that time, Kono, you know, leaves as a parting gift the Kono statement. And of course, it's a political decision, right? Because they have conducted a government investigation on the sex slave issue, they had the findings, they were ready to issue the statement, but of course they lost the election. And what to do with it? Do you pass it on to the next guy, or do you kind of, you know, do it because you're going anyway? And of course, you can expect that the conservatives within the LDP would be seriously angered by the Kono statement. But Kono decided that, you know, he's going to have it out, and then Hosokawa wouldn't have to deal with it then. And so, in other words, LDP or not, there was sort of some sort of liberal consensus at the time, that, you know, internationalist consensus at the time. And in fact, the transition from Miyazawa and Kono to Hosokawa and Takemura was actually much more smooth than it might appear in terms of ideological standing. But of course, from Abe's point of view, it's an unforgivable crime. A government that is already lame duck and is going, you know, issues that statement and then it disappears. And of course, Kono then becomes the president of the LDP. So, you know, Abe is not only in, you know, in opposition, but the president of his own party is this traitor who issued the Kono statement. So, you know, you can imagine the anger and the frustration Abe felt as the, you know, as a very young politician at the time. And not only that, of course, the LDP, including Abe, had to crawl back to power by supporting a socialist prime minister of all things. And this socialist prime minister issued the Murayama statement. So, you know, you put yourself in Abe's position, you can imagine the frustration and anger, and in fact, the sense of victimization, that he's the victim of this, that he's, you know, Japan is surrounded by hostile neighbors, and our leaders are traitors, and they are wimps, and they are selling out Japan's interest, and agreeing to a story that is not true, and this is all unforgivable sin. So this is the kind of emotion that Abe must have gone through as a young parliamentarian. In fact, the Murayama statement is a direct result of the sabotaging act of people like Abe in the Diet, in the parliament. Because Murayama statement was in fact issued from the government because of the legislature's inability to pass a more thorough resolution against the war. You know, the 50th anniversary of the end of the Second World War was a very significant year. And so all eyes were on Japan in terms of what it's going to do in order to, you know, break with the past. The Diet, under the leadership of the coalition government at the time, tried to come up with a firm resolution that was going to renounce war and pledge Japan to be a peaceful country, never ever repeating the, you know, the wartime atrocities and all that. Abe is among those conservatives who reacted very strongly and made speeches in the Diet against them. And Abe, in fact, absented himself from the Diet resolution. And the Diet resolution at the end of the day was passed, but it was passed only by a majority, breaking the convention that Diet resolutions are always passed unanimously by the whole House. And in fact, it wasn't just the conservatives who walked out from the resolution. The communists and the left parties also walked out because they, from their point of view, was too watered down to agree to. And so, based on that failure, Murayama determined that he had to do this Murayama statement. And so that's why he did it. But of course, you know, that is not something that Abe could accept. The revisionism really begins at a specific time. And in fact, you know, according to my own analysis, you can name the year 1997 as the first year of the revisionist backlash in Japan, 1997. So you see a very abrupt change of mood from 1997. And this is in direct reaction to Murayama's statement and the Asian Women's Fund efforts and all that, but more specifically, the last straw in the eyes of the conservative revisionists like Abe was the news in summer, I think, in 1996, that the history textbooks that were to be used in the Japanese junior high schools from 1997, the following year, were all going to include reference to comfort women. I mean, it's not like there's a whole description of the comfort woman, but there was going to be, you know, the term comfort woman, hyanfu, in the textbook. And the fact that they were mobilized and they were, you know, part of the Japanese, you know, military. And that reference was included in all of the textbooks approved by the Minister of Education to be used from 1997. And that news came out in 1996. And the conservatives thought that that enough was enough. And they couldn't take it anymore. And what they decided to do is this, because previously, and one of the reasons why so many people misunderstand that Japan never really quite apologized is the fact that there were a series of ministers and senior political figures who made offensive comments, right? And so at the time when Nakasone stopped visiting the Yasukuni Shrine, or, you know, Kono statement is issued, or Murayama statement is issued, these significant, you know, attempts at reconciliation were overshadowed by individual ministers and senior political figures who say things like Nanjing massacre never happened, or comfort women were all prostitutes, or, you know, Japan did good things in Korea and stuff like that. And so previously, because the mainstream of the LDP were generally sharing this liberal internationalist ideology, they wouldn't allow those people to stay on. And so these gaffes, these offensive comments, resulted in ministerial resignations each time. And sometimes the minister took back and apologized, sometimes the ministers were simply fired because they refused to change their position. And so at that time, it was really as if those, you know, nationalist revisionists were individually marching ahead with bamboo spears to fight against the enemies, but because their weapons were very meager and of course they were divided, they were all kind of, you know, cast aside. What they decided to do is to revise the tactic and to group themselves together and to form something like a real army rather than going and being defeated individually. And so in 1997, that really starts in earnest. In January 1997, the Tsukurukai, the Association for a New History Textbook, the Revisionist History Textbook Association that was launched by the manga artist Kobayashi Yoshinori and some other media figures, some intellectuals, nationalist intellectuals, was formed in January of 1997. In February of the same year, Abe, the late Nakagawa Shoichi, and some other youthful parliamentarians, tens of youthful parliamentarians, mostly of the LDP, create this new association of young parliamentarians that consider Japan's future and history education. 日本の前途と歴史教育を考える若手議員の会. That's the name of the association. This group is a specifically revisionist lobbying group. And they were specifically reacting to the inclusion of the reference to comfort women in the history textbooks. Their objective was to take those references out. And in fact, Abe is in on the record on a book that they published themselves, which you can still buy through Amazon and whatever, in which Abe is actually making the comment that Korea has this prostitute culture and, you know, comfort women, prostitutes, you know, same thing. So he's on the record having said that as a young parliamentarian. And so, you know, you see that his views are genuine and long embedded. But anyway, so this group starts to get active also. And from these years, from these early years already, they are also collaborating very closely with other organizations. And of the same year later, I think it was in May, Nihon Kaigi is born also. Nihon Kaigi is a result, Japan Conference is a result of the merger of, on the one hand, a group of nationalist intellectuals led by people like the kind of composer Mayuzumi Toshiro, among others, and on the other hand, another group that was mostly consisting of the Shintoist Association, New Religions, that held nationalistic, revisionist views. And so you see the public intellectuals and media figures coming together with New Religions and Shintoism that have certain mobilizing power. And they also, of course, find the media platform in Sankei group outlets, particularly the monthly magazine Shokun, Sankei is Seiron, and Bungei Shunju, monthly magazine Shokun, from these early years. And so they, you know, they come really to get organized, and they, it's interesting because with the revisionism from that time onwards becoming stronger and stronger, you actually see fewer resignations of ministers because they don't have to anymore. And they don't have to do that in that way. They are, you know, they have better channels to apply pressure. So the LDP on the surface remains the same party, but from the latter half of the 1990s, significant revisionist changes are happening, and that come out in the open from the Koizumi in particular. But you know, you need to understand also, some of you may remember the famous gaffe made by Mori when he was Prime Minister about Japan being a divine country. You know, a speech he was making in Shinto, you know, Seiji Renme, the political association of Shintoism. It is in that context that Mori was saying that. So he was aware of the undercurrent, the young undercurrent, the new generation of revisionists coming up within the LDP, and he was going to be the big mentor of that. And so it is in that context that that, you know, that, that statement was made. And Koizumi, of course, having seized power and having visited the Yasukuni shrine every year, in spite of the protest, he also promoted this new young generation of revisionists to top ministerial ranks. Abe in particular, but many others, like I mentioned, Nakagawa, Aso, Hiranuma, all these people, younger revisionists, were, you know, now groomed as the successor. So it is in that kind of context that Koizumi dared to say that as long as, you know, the relationship with the United States is fine, everything else would follow. And so he basically, you know, brushed aside Chinese and South Korean criticism. And he said it doesn't matter. And this is a very significant change that happened during that period. Of course, Abe succeeds to the Koizumi agenda in many ways. And the difference between Koizumi and Abe is that Koizumi was, in some ways, using the revisionist agenda, because he himself doesn't really care that much about history. He's not much of a nationalist. He's much more of a neoliberal. But he used nationalism and the revisionist ties in order to shore up his power position. But Abe, of course, is a true believer. I think we all know that he's not into politics in order to make Abenomics a success. You know, it's only an instrument for his more central agenda, that is revisionism of history, but also in connection to the revision of the constitution. To discuss a bit more specifically about Abe in the remainder of the time, of course, he wants to revise the Kono statement. He wants to revise the Murayama statement, but he's not allowed to do that by the United States. The United States was very concerned, the Obama administration was very concerned when Abe came back to power that Abe was going to do all these things. And so from day one, they were sending signals, trying to tell him, I talk him out of revising the Kono statement and Murayama statement. And so what Abe is trying to do now is to do that through the back door. Right? Because he can't be caught red-handed revising those statements. That would offend the Americans too much. And of course, he got a slap in his hand when he visited the Yasukuni shrine and the, you know, Caroline Kennedy issued the statement of disappointment. And so what he has done is, of course, to try to undermine Kono's statement by reviewing the process of the making of the Kono statement and by revealing to the public that it was actually a result of a diplomatic discussion with the South Korean government. I mean, there's not much surprise there, but of course, what he wanted to do is to undermine the credibility of the Kono statement in terms of historical truthfulness by saying that the South Korean diplomats were lobbying Japan, and this is why Kono statement was issued. With regard to Murayama statement, of course, he's currently working on it with the Abe government, Abe statement, and already we all saw the sign of what it might be by the omission to some certain keywords like colonial rule, aggression, and heartfelt apology in the speech he just made only days ago in Jakarta. And so he's most likely not to keep those keywords and just get away with one word, which is Hansei in Japanese, but in English a much stronger translation in the term remorse. So the Americans apparently gave an okay to that because, of course, in English, remorse, you know, also has the nuance of accompanying guilt, inner guilt and recognition of fault. Whereas in the Japanese term, fukai hansei, this is rather more ambiguous. You know, you can do hansei about all kinds of things. Why didn't we win that war? That would be a form of hansei too, I think. But, you know, remorse is a very convenient label, if you like, but, you know, it's also a blunt lie, you know, depending on the perspective. In terms of education, in particular in history textbooks, again, he's also going through the revision of the textbooks, and the outcome were discussed several weeks ago in terms of what was going to be included in the history textbooks, what is not going to be included in the history textbooks. But the government of Abe is doing it again also fairly subtly by insisting that history textbooks are not going to be approved unless they refer to the official government position if it's a matter of historical controversy. If there is an official government position, then the textbook has to refer to the Japanese government position. And the other thing that they are demanding is that when there is a controversy over specific numbers of people who are killed or people who are mobilized, then you have to mention all possibilities, that you can't just take side and decide on a higher figure or lower figure. You have to be all inclusive, which of course means that if revisionist historians work up a very small number, that needs to be referred to as well. In terms of the educational issues, he's also working on moral education. Moral education is coming back. Of course, what they idolize and what they kind of, you know, have as a model is the pre-war, moral education in many ways. And that is also to do with the stronger government control of schools. And this is to do with the school principals, getting more specific orders and authority to decide what to do, and school ceremonies, and whatnot. But also, Abe government is showing ambitions that they want to also affect the universities as well. That is also a somewhat worrisome tendency. Combined to that, I think I'm running out of time, so I'm going to go through very quickly, but if you have questions, please feel free to ask. What is interesting, of course, is that Abe's nationalistic sort of revisionist agenda in education is combined with a seemingly contradictory set of neoliberal reforms too. So in a way, he's trying to nationalize education more, but he's also trying to denationalize it at the same time by giving more authority to local chief executives, for example, when it comes to the content of education. He's also deregulating some of the new kind of type of schools, the so-called free schools or night schools or international schools. They appear contradictory, and they are to a degree, but I think they are also somewhat connected. And the reason why I think they're somewhat connected is the fact that, and this is what is interesting, I think, and maybe certain useful comparison between France and Japan. Because both France and Japan have been noted for state-led mode of modernization. We both have state bureaucracy that are dominant and overbearing and elitistic and all that sort of thing, right? And in that sense, the two countries are very similar. But when you actually look at the size of the public sector, the size of the state, in terms of the budget, but also in terms of personnel that those states employ, Japan actually is a small state. Japan is a small state and has always been a small state because it's a late developing country. The state never had the full amount of money to spend. And so from the Meiji period onwards, Japan's statism is similar but different from France's in the sense that the Japanese statism is done on the cheap. The state controlled the ideological machinery much more effectively and employed that much more effectively in order to inculcate patriotism and servitude to the state, to the nationals and to the pupils of Japan, and mobilize them voluntarily. And so instead of having a heavy-handed, well-built and expensive state machinery to mobilize the people, the Japanese preferred method throughout the modernization period and even today has been to do it on the cheap, using ideological devices. And in that respect, in fact, there's not much contradiction with the neoliberal reforms. Because you have the pensée unique, you have this compulsion that there's only one way of doing it, and in fact concentrate power around the CEOs or around the prime minister and so forth. And then you can expect the workers or the pupils, the students, to behave much as those people who hold power want them to behave. And so in that respect, I think the moral education and the desire to control the schools are not necessarily contradictory to the neoliberal reforms that are pushed also. So maybe I stop here for now. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for this wonderful lecture. My name is Michel Lafisse. I would like to know what is it, according to you, what is the ultimate goal of Mr. Abe?
Thank you for your question. I don't know. The reason why I don't know is because I have the suspicion that they don't know either. The reason why I think so is because, in a way it's not surprising because fundamentally this is a reactionary movement. You know, this is a reactionary conservative movement. So they are reacting to something, and they are not actionary in the sense that they are not the ones who are initiating the actions. They have this kind of paradigm that is very much informed by the victimhood mentality. And Abe is really that. You know, this idea of Nihon Torimodosu to begin with, you have to assume that you are a victim to say that you want to take it back. And as I said, you know, in his political career, you see that. But the other thing that I didn't have the time to refer to, and I think, you know, the reason why I think he's so reactionary and mired in victimhood mentality is because his rise to prominence was very much associated with the North Korean abduction issue, as you know. And the North Korean abduction issue became very prominent again in the late 1990s when Abe was, you know, rising in prominence. But, and he became the one, the champion of that issue during the Koizumi years in particular. But that incident is a very clear example, perhaps quite a unique example, in which the Japanese are victims. And that was so liberating for people like Abe, right? Because in Asia, you know, Japan is usually the aggressor. At least you have to come up with all kinds of excuses to say, we are not. But with North Korean abduction issue, you know, he was very confident that we are the victims, and he prospered in that. And so this attitude is really to do with taking back, again, of course, is a reference to that as well. Torimodosu, as in Torimodosu Megumi-san. You know, so this is the kind of idea. And Japan is being used, it's being victimized because it's too naive and it's been too nice and we have to be tougher. But he doesn't quite know how tough he wants to get. You know, that's the kind of thing. I mean, he wants to revise and he wants to restore honor to Japan. But how far can he go? You know, to a degree depends on the Americans. You know, would the Americans, you know, let him do this or that? And that is now key. And you see that also in the making of the Abe statement. Right? In Murayama's statement, the key people who drafted the Murayama statement were diplomats in the Gaimusho who are China hands from the China school. Today, you know, Abe set up this panel of experts, and then I think there are a dozen people there. There's only one China expert. There's zero Korean expert. And they are issuing a statement about the 70th anniversary. But instead of the experts on China and Korea, they have plenty of people with close ties with American elites, including the America bureau chief of Yomiuri Shimbun, and many business leaders who had career in the United States. So the only reaction they are worried about is the United States. And it depends on, you know, how much of revisionism would the Americans allow. Because in his view, it's kind of a barter. You know, he gives things like the collective self-defense, state secrets law, TPP, not joining AIIB, and then he gets in return permission to indulge in revisionism. And this actually also was a combination, kind of package that Koizumi got from Bush too.
Primarily, take your thought. Concerning the tendency of Mr. Abe support the militarism during the Second World War in terms of revisionist, I think it's because he was influenced by his grandfather, Mr. Nobusuke Kishi. So because he was former executive of the military during the Second World War. So in the process of growth, sometimes I suppose that Mr. Kishi told Shinzo-san the cause of the militarism in its way. So I think his structure of the idea about the Second World War was formed. So I think so, partially. So what is your supposition about it?
Thank you. Well, I mean, one correction, I think minor correction, is that Kishi was not a military leader. He was a civil bureaucrat, but worked very closely with the militarists. that is true. And I think there is a strong influence from Kishi, and in the sense that Abe seems to really look up to Kishi, you know, as a model. And of course, you know, I can't really understand the psychology of Mr. Abe, and I'm not quite sure whether I want to understand it either. But from what I heard, I mean, I've never really interviewed Mr. Abe either, but from what I heard, he's even today under considerable influence from his own mother, who's the daughter of Kishi. And that's why they have the different surnames. But, you know, because his own father, who's rarely ever mentioned by Abe Shintaro, is actually a rather much more moderate figure. He was married to Kishi's daughter. And Kishi's daughter, Abe's mother, was somewhat dissatisfied with her own husband, who is not as strong of a man as her father was. And it seems that, from what I heard, they still talk very often, and that's how, you know, his mother's influence may be an intermediary of the influence coming from Kishi. I mean, having said that, I think there is one big difference between Kishi and Abe, and that is a lot to do with the change of the context. Because Kishi Nobusuke was, you know, was actually pro-welfare state. And that is not entirely surprising because, of course, he was something of a national socialist, also known as a Nazi. But, you know, national socialist, he was also this view that under the emperor, Japan should be much more equal. And, of course, you need to have healthy nationals in order to have a strong army. And so, you know, in the wartime, of course, it was the military that created the what's become Koseishon. Because you need to have a healthy body in order to, you know, win the war, right? So from that point of view, Kishi continued to be a sort of a, you know, from today's ideological paradigm, an interesting figure. But of course, at that time, he was quite normal. He was a kind of a progressive nationalist in the sense that, in fact, when he re-entered politics in the post-war, he initially asked the socialists whether they would let him in. The socialists said no. And so he couldn't join the socialists. But he is, in fact, the one who built the pension system in post-war Japan. He's the one who set up the minimum wage in Japan in the post-war period. So, you know, he did that sort of change in the 1950s, and Abe is not like that at all. I mean, he's a creature of the neoliberal post-coisonic period. And so, you know, he's cutting welfare at the time when precarious jobs are on the rise and poverty is getting worse. You know, his view is that as long as the Americans are okay with that, then we're okay with that. So,
after the end of the war, so the American imposed a new constitution, and I think there was mainly three points. One was the emperor, so became just a symbol, and then they're renouncing the war, and the last one was the democracy. And I think I heard that the announcement of the war was not really imposed by the U.S., but was a proposal from the Sugihara. But obviously, the democracy was not proposed by the Japanese side at all, but completely imposed. So we're talking about revision of the constitution, but we're talking mainly about the role of the self-defense. But isn't the purpose a bit further on, is take out the democracy and go back to the system that came before?
Well, it's an interesting question because, of course, as you noted, for much of the post-war period, when it comes to debate about constitutional revision, it was about Article 9, you know, the pacifist clause. But there has been changes in the recent years. And particularly, it became quite concrete from 2013, so, you know, 2 years ago now. And I say 2 years ago now because that was the time when Abe seriously contemplated revising Article 96 of the Constitution, which is the clause that set the hurdles for the conditions for constitutional revision. You know, as many of you would know, you require two-thirds majority in both houses to initiate a national referendum where you need to get a simple majority to change the Constitution. And of course, that's a very high hurdle to cross. And so Abe thought that it would be a good idea to reduce the requirements to just a simple majority in both houses and a majority again in the national referendum. And the background of that proposal was the fact that new parties like what's today Ishinoto, the Restoration Party of Hashimoto and others, were proposing that too. Or your party, Minnanoto, which doesn't exist anymore. But, you know, those parties were looking into that. And the other background to that was that the LDP, while in opposition, worked a new draft of the revised proposal for constitution, which was a thorough document of really rewriting just about everything. And so what we see today is no longer a focus on Article 9, partially because it remains the biggest controversy, but partially because Article 9 is much less of a hurdle today. I mean, he changed the revision of the constitution, and the Japanese military can do pretty much anything he wants to do, you know, if the laws are passed. And therefore, changing Article 9 is only going to be post facto endorsing what is already been, is happening now. And so they have other priorities. And what they are thinking is that they want to rewrite their own constitution for nationalistic reasons, because they see the document as largely American imposed. And so they want to do it themselves. And so, you know, if you take a look at the draft proposal for a new constitution in the LDP website, it's a very, very thorough document. And it goes so far as to denounce basically, I mean, to attach qualifiers for basic human rights, for example, right? Human rights will be guaranteed as long as it doesn't conflict with public order and interest. Scary. Or the article that says slavery is abolished is taken out. So does that mean slavery is going to be revived? I don't know. But, you know, so there are those, you know, rather worrisome changes that are being proposed seriously by the LDP. It's an official document approved by the LDP under Taniyaki, not even under Abe. So you have that. And for now, they are thinking of getting ahead with revising the constitution formally in autumn next year. Once the upper house election is done in July next year, they hope to get a large majority. They hope to get help from other parties, and they'll have enough to go over the two-thirds majority. And the key, of course, is that the upper house elections are very hard to win in Japan. You know, because since 1989, even today, the LDP doesn't have a majority on its own in the upper house. So it's extraordinarily difficult to win. So they need other parties. Komeito is there, but they need to have other parties as well. And what they are thinking of doing is to break in the DPJ so that there's not going to be significant opposition. Because they want to break the DPJ, they are proposing at the moment to insert a new set of clauses in the constitution that have to do with emergency situation, kinkyu jitai. And the reason why they are talking about that is that back in the Koizumi years, toward the end of the Koizumi period, so around 2006 or so, the DPJ, which was in opposition at the time, was very keen to pass a law on emergency situation. But Koizumi lost interest because he was more keen to push ahead the postal privatization, so it never happened. And in fact, Abe was the chief cabinet secretary at the time, and he has said in an interview that, well, you actually don't need laws to prepare for emergency, you know, situation, because the existing laws are just fine. But for opportunistic reasons, he wanted to change the constitution. Even though he said in the past, even laws are not necessary. Now the constitution needs to be revised for Japan to be better prepared for emergency situation. And that is only to do with the fact that the DPJ can easily be divided if that's the ball he throws. And so it's very cleverly done. It's very cynical, of course, as a move. But they are thinking that this is only the thin end of the wedge. They want to get ahead and try to revise other things.
My question is, do you or your colleague feel some threat about free thought in universities? This is one question. On the second question is, as it was said at the beginning, what we are discussing today is a hot topic. So have you been, I don't know, maybe threatened by someone or not? Maybe it's
I will be, because it's on YouTube. No, thank you for your question. No, I haven't been. I mean, I receive unpleasant emails and, you know, postcards from time to time, but it doesn't really matter. But seriously, I think there are people who have been, you know, target of persecution. And one in particular is this person, Mr. Uemura Takashi, who used to be an Asahi reporter. And he lost a job in Kansai area. He got a part-time teaching job in Sapporo in a private university. But even that, you know, was, you know, becoming, was very, you know, vulnerable at a certain time around, you know, early this year. I was part of a movement to try to, you know, keep him in the position, because there was a concerted attack from the right wing to have him fired, to terminate his contract. And he almost lost it. But the civil society reaction was strong, and in fact there was also international, you know, group of scholars who also voiced their views, and all of that, and journalists who also covered the story, and eventually the mood changed, and the university kept him for the year. But he was turned into a scapegoat, because he's a Nasahi reporter who wrote certain articles on the comfort women issue. And he's married to a Korean woman. And the, you know, the mother-in-law is an active person on that cause. But, you know, when Asahi retracted articles based on the false Yoshida testimony, even though Mr. Uemura has not written one single article using Yoshida testimony, because the government used the Asahi retraction in order to engage in a campaign to mislead people as if the whole comfort women system was an Asahi fabrication, you know, Uemura-san became under very severe attack. And so this kind of thing can happen. And there are other stories, like, you know, it's somebody in Hiroshima University, you know, getting in trouble because Sankei put out an opinion piece, I think, about a student who was unhappy that a Korean comfort woman documentary movie was shown in a lecture, and you know, how scandalous that is, and then there were thousands of phone calls to Hiroshima University. So these kind of things do happen, and in that sense, it's kind of dangerous. And the other thing more recently is that thing that happened with the national anthem. In the parliamentary exchange, a member of a right-wing party, which is not the LDP, asked the question whether, you know, he thinks that Abe and others think that the national anthem should be sung in the school ceremonies, well, not just in school ceremonies, but at the university ceremonies as well, national universities, because they're receiving taxpayers' money. And he said, you know, well, kind of think so. Of course, they don't have the power to enforce it, but the fact that the Prime Minister doesn't hesitate to take such a position publicly, my colleagues in national universities talked about, because they don't want to be forced to sing. And would there be video recording of people who are singing, you know, whether we are lip syncing or whatever? I mean, you know, the idea of coercing university professors to sing the national anthem, you know, is plain stupid in a global, you know, context in particular. But this is the kind of thing that is ongoing. And so the attack on the media is also, you know, going to, I think it's coming in that sense. So it's still not very significant. I'm not personally affected yet, but I think it's going to come. The reason why I say this is because, precisely because of this agenda for constitutional revision, right? Because they don't want us to influence the students. And so people who are seen as anti-Japanese from their perspective, you know, need to be intimidated so that they don't, you know, they don't speak up. And they're doing that with the media, of course, as, you know, several cases show. But they are also going to reinforce that tactic with the universities and schools, I'm sure. The other interesting thing, of course, is that, you know, even on the political left, you know, pacifism in Japan is based on the narrative of being a victim. You know, because there's Hiroshima, Nagasaki, there's a Tokyo Air Race, and so, you know, the narrative of anti-war movement in Japan has always been that war is rather like a natural disaster. It's horrible, everybody is hurt, it should never be repeated. It's a form of pacifism, but it's a kind of a pacifism that never really, you know, tried to very forcefully bring people who are responsible to account. And that is a very peculiar thing. And maybe not particularly surprising in the sense that, you know, people did suffer. I mean, soldiers suffered because they were dying of hunger, right? As many of you would probably know, the, you know, most important cause of death of Japanese soldiers were hunger and hunger-related illness. It wasn't like people were killed in action. They had nothing to eat and they died. And so those people who made it back, they're not going to brag about how many Chinese women they raped or killed. They were going to say, we all suffered, it was horrible. I mean, we had nothing to eat. And it's not untrue either. And so the post-war narrative tended to be that wars are horrible, we shouldn't be repeating ever again, but without really putting a finger on, so who's responsible, why did it happen? What can we do to ensure that it will never happen? It's talked like it's a natural disaster.
Thank you very much for your talk. And I'm an educationist, and I really worry about the recent movement initiated by Abe. And one piece of news, which we were educationists were very surprised last year, was that Mr. Abe, this is one of the what we call free schools in September, I think.
Yes.
And free school is, there are 170,000 out-of-school children in Japan. They're sort of school refusers. They hate being opposed by any nationalistic views, including the national flags and songs, you know, anthem. And Mr. Abe visited the Tokyo Shure, which is the world, I think the most, the biggest free school in the world, I think, one of them. And they hate this kind of nationalist movement, obviously, teachers and learners, children. But he visited, and he sang a song with these out-of-school children, happily, looked happily, and we are very surprised. And obviously, this kind of a movement of imposing a moral education and also textbooks, etc., are against their philosophy. And this is a totally contradict for all of us. What do you think?
I knew about the visit, and I was also very interested to hear what you have to say. And it's only a guess, but I'm wondering how significant was the influence of Shimomura Hakubun in that, because Shimomura is the Minister of Education, and he's ideologically very close to Abe, but he's also somebody who's receiving lots of support from the non-formal sector of the education industry, right? Because he's got very close ties with the cram schools, the juku industry, and he seems to get, you know, even dodgy funds from these people. And so, and of course, Shimomura in his own way is also a controversial figure because on the one hand, he emphasized nationalistic education at formal schools, but his own children, or son at least, you know, he's studying abroad now and have gone through the international schools, I think, actually. So, you know, there's a kind of a contradiction there in terms of what he does to his own son. So partially it could do to do with some sort of rather less ideological but more materialistic motivation in terms of, you know, helping Shimomura get some sort of leverage over, or more leverage over that kind of sector, informal sector of the education industry. That's one thing. And the other thing that I'm wondering, and I'm sorry, I'm only wondering about these things, I have no answer. But the other thing I'm wondering is how much they are looking at this, and even though Tokyo Shuri, as you said, is rather progressive and, you know, very antithetical to Abe's nationalism, they must be aware of the American example of homeschools or, you know, counterparts of free schools, where you can skip the formal education by having your children, you know, receive homeschooling, or, you know, very kind of heavily Christian education in a rather more informal setting. And so this might be to do with, even though I would imagine it's very, very small, this might be a kind of thing that new religions may find an interest into in the future. And so even though the free schools for the moment are rather more progressive in nature overall, are they looking at the other examples or charter schools or, you know, in the US or in the UK in terms of, you know, I wouldn't say indoctrination, but in terms of, you know, somewhat ideological education in a way that is different from what exists.
Thank you very much for your speech. I have a question for you. You are a specialist in comparative politics. And so I'd like to ask you this question. On a scale of 1 to 10, how would you rate America or France as a nationalistic, militaristic country? Where do you think Japan, Abe and his followers would want Japan to be on such a scale?
Thank you. That's a very interesting question. That's a good question too, because I don't want you to think that, you know, I'm saying that Japan is the only country turning to the right. In fact, my whole point, you know, I'm writing a book about it, but you know, in general, I mean, I take the view, which is not going to cheer you up, but I think the whole world is going in that direction, and Japan is only part of it. And so in that respect, it's very difficult to compare, because I think, you know, in Europe, of course, including France, you know, I think many in anti-Muslim or anti-immigration or anti-Europe extreme parties are on the rise. You know, they're often occupying a third party position increasingly, and certainly so also in France. And you know, it looks like also in the UK in the coming weeks. And in, you know, in the United States, you have the Tea Party takeover of the Republican Party. And you know, these kind of nationalist tendencies are in evidence, of course, in South Korea too, and also in China. So you know, you have this kind of rather puzzling seemingly contradictory phenomenon, where you have the global economy, you know, giving birth to more and more nationalistic politics all around. I think there's a certain mechanism that can explain that, why that is happening. But in terms of Japan, it depends on, I mean, okay, so nationalism, right? Nationalism in particular. In terms of revisionism, I think Japan is quite extreme. And it's very hard to find. I mean, revisionism does exist in other countries as well. Kind of revisionist backlash do happen in the United States, I'm sure in France also to a degree. And so they do exist, but in Japan, it's now mainstream. You know, it's mainstream, it's governing us. And that's bad. You know, that is quite bad. I think maybe Russia is in sort of looking similar under Putin increasingly, but you know, for a democratic country, it's really pretty bad. When it comes to nationalism with, you know, in relation to security arrangement, of course, you know, Japan is still relatively, you know, peaceful in the sense that Japan has not fought a war yet. I'm concerned in that respect as well, because you know, I do have colleagues and friends in political science in Japan and beyond who kind of, you know, disagree very much with what the kind of view I have about where Japan stands, because they argue that, look, Japan is still very peaceful compared to the United States. You know, Japan is still constrained. And I think it's true to a degree. But what is kind of dangerous is this, and this is in relation to Article 9 and the other parts of the Constitution as well. Because we have Article 9, the whole Constitution does not expect Japan to go to war. And so it's like the marginal line mentality, you know, in France. If you have that, you know, crossed, then there's no defense. You know, once you have Article 9 negated, in fact, the whole Constitution needs to be revised, because there's no stop of any kind of how to control the military, which is not supposed to exist in the first place. So for example, the Constitution clearly bans the setting up of anything other than ordinary courts. So military tribunals are unconstitutional in Japan. What do you do when you have a real military? For now, we only have a self-defense force. So if there's anything that happens, they are tried in ordinary courts. But if Japan starts to have people who kill and who get killed, and who probably also desert because they don't want to stay in the military when it, you know, Japan starts to really fight, then you have to change the constitution in order to, you know, have a military tribunal. There's no other way of doing it because it's specifically banned. And so, you know, we have no constitutional stipulation how to start and end the war, for example. There's nothing at all because wars are not supposed to be something Japan does. And so that is how it's significant. And that's how, you know, the way in which they're undermining constitutionalism by trying to change Article 96 and more recently by changing just the interpretation of the constitution and negating the power of Article 9 is very dangerous. Superficially, nothing has not changed. But below the surface, it's like completely empty now. Can you give us a little bit of hope? Could you tell us something about the dynamics which could fight against this kind of tendency? Thank you. Well, I mean, I think even though it is yet to be translated into real political force, on the societal level, I see a lot of changes that are happening. And this is particularly after the nuclear power accident, you know, in Fukushima. The civil society actors, I mean, you know, by Japanese standards, of course, this is not France. So, you know, you don't have demonstrations and strikes on a regular basis. But, you know, by Japanese standards, more people are taking to the streets. They are less afraid of voicing their views. And in fact, there is also rejuvenation of the protests. And so, you know, it's not the baby boom generation old timers who are doing it still, and they're still there. But in addition, you see a younger generation coming in, and some of them even college students joining the protest. And for example, in the protest against the state secrets law in December 2013, you know, there were lots of young people, and they got organized, and they used the latest IT technologies to communicate together, to spread information, come up with very clever video, and stuff like that. And so it is encouraging. And I think it's not just, you know, one issue, but it's kind of really, you know, going into a different direction. Anti-racism, anti-hate, and, you know, feminism, you know, there are all kinds of, you know, areas in which you see more engagement. And I would say also partially because I'm also, you know, involved, but I think the same can be said about scholarly community. It's not just that the university people are getting a feeling that the intimidation might come to our way, but there are more people who are speaking up also at the same time. Maybe I would say there's kind of a bipolarization. You know, there are people who are becoming silent, but there are also a fewer number of people who are now beginning to get more politically engaged because seems like we are, you know, going in the wrong direction. So I think these things are, you know, quite encouraging. And I certainly haven't lost hope, even though I'm not very optimistic, to be honest. Even if it's a losing battle, it's a fight that we can't flee from. And so I think we'll see more of that in the coming months and years.
Okay, thank you so much. We have many, many things to discuss more. Maybe we invite you again. It's time for us today. Thank you so much to be here. And we have questions with clients. We are, next time will be in May, the 21st of May, and then the 19th of June. It will be more on, about women issues. But it is related in kind of way to this speech. Thank you.